This is what I was talking about in last week's episode, right at the end. Remember I said a little surprise? Well, this is that little surprise. I saw him just standing there when I came out to water and feed the animals the other day. He was just sitting down there with that weird swallow frown on his face. They got the cutest faces. And he was just giving me this look. I walked right past him, I fed the animals, I came back, and he's still staring at me. And I noticed that the mom and dad came flying by and they were dive bombing me like mad. Of course, you know, they just assumed that I'm there to cause their baby danger. And so I made sure that I walked around it. I don't get anywhere near it when the mom and dad are around. And I don't grab him and hold him. And he's not a pet. He's a wild critter. And he's in my shed. So I made sure that at night I grab everything that I need out of my shed for the next day because I don't want to have to deal with them. I don't want to have to mess with them. I don't want to cause them any kind of fear. I don't want to mess with the babies. This is their job. What happened is the babies, there's so many of them, they crowded the nest. There's six babies in this nest. Oh, hold on a second. This is kind of disconcerting. Let me back you off just a little bit. Critters jumping in and around over there. You see that? Yep. This is the baby swallow. And he just sits there. And he's not afraid of me or anything like that because I don't make any sudden movements. And he's seen me since he was a baby. And he just watches me. The parents don't much care for me. See, they're buzzing my head right now and they're screaming. You can hear that. But they're not actually trying to attack me. They're just warning me. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to walk away from him. But I wanted to show you. That's the little one who watches me. And I'm probably going to get a shot of the other ones in there. Now what happened? Oh, hold on. Let me just move the camera and I'll continue with the program. He's a cute little bugger, isn't he? Yeah, he is. The whole cycle happened right in front of my face. I watched them from the time they started building their nest. They laid their eggs. They hatched their young. Now they're feeding them like mad. And normally, from the nests that I've seen, because I have a lower shed down there, an old shed that's falling apart, the swallows used to go down there for the last few years, and I've noticed their nests. Well, one thing I did notice is that they would start out with a whole bunch of little babies, and then later on I'd see less, and I don't know why. I'm assuming the stronger ones pushed the weaker ones out of the nest as they got too big, because you think about it, six babies is a lot to fit into that little itty-bitty nest once they get bigger. Once they get old enough, they're so big, they can't fit in the nest. They actually have to stand on the perimeter of the nest. And so what happens is the parents swoop in and they feed the biggest mouth that's right in front of their face. The littler ones get pushed to the side. They get weaker. This is nature. It's not, you know, nature's not always kind, but that's just how it is. Survival of the fittest. And I think what happens is the stronger ones push the weaker ones out of the nest, because later on I'd only see about four. And for 2 years in a row, the parents down there raised only four, but I saw more earlier in the season. This one had six babies, and they don't fit in the nest. This one either got pushed out or jumped out. But what I did notice, because I would have taken a hand in this if I thought that the baby was in danger. What I noticed is the baby flaps its wings like mad and screams when the parents are flying in to feed the other ones. And every now and then they swoop down and they feed that one too. So they are taking care of their baby. And since I got the rat, I haven't rid myself totally of the rats because they did come back a little bit, but I got them under control. And the rats aren't bothering them because I figured the rats might come in and eat the babies. Well, the rats haven't been bothering them, which is really kind of nice. And this one flew down off the nest, and I have my stove in there. That's the stove I'm going to be cooking my compost in. And the stove is right underneath it. I put a towel, I took one of my bath towels, and I put it on top of the stove as a cushion for when this baby keeps jumping out of the nest. It lands on the towel, and it stands on the edge of the towel and waits for parents. Well, this morning it decided to go for a walk. So that's just how it is. That's that's my little surprises for today. But anyway, welcome back to the farm. I really do appreciate you dropping by. Today is going to be hot. You know, I filmed last week's episode just a little bit ago, and the sun's coming up. I can feel the heat and the humidity starting to set in, but I still got about another half an hour. So I got plenty of time. There's a nice breeze. I have to get something out of here. Hot weather. hot weather in July in Iowa. And those of you even farther south, I know exactly what you're going through. It's even worse than what I have here. Now, hot weather, certain crops are not going to survive. I grow radishes in the spring. And you saw the big radishes over here. Well, I pulled them out. And the French breakfasts are over just to your left. You can see the little flowers and everything. Well, they already bolted. And I could have eaten them as bulbs, but I wanted to get a secondary harvest out of them. Not as in bulbs, but the pods. And the pods are starting to ripen up. I know, you're in charge. You can just hear them screaming, but they're not attacking me. When they attack me, I know it because they come within like a foot of my head. So they're just letting me know that their baby is down there, and I respect that. But the pods over here from the radishes, yeah, I got off my butt. I'm going to do something today. This is what I was talking about for a secondary harvest. Hold on, I want to bring it to you. Let me set these down. I'm going to show you what I'm talking about. Let me show you what I'm talking about. This. See? If you allow your radishes to continue to grow and they bolt, you don't need to pull them out. It's not a waste. Or if they don't form bulbs, it's not a waste. Let them grow. They will form these pods. Now, while they're still green at any size, the smaller the better, pop one in your mouth. No, seriously, pop one in your mouth, chew it up, and you're going to be in for a real delight. It's got a cabbagey, mild flavor. It's kind of a cross, in my opinion, between radish and cabbage. It's absolutely delicious, and I've cooked with these too. You can pop these things out, and they produce millions of them. See, that's the wonder that is radishes. When you grow a radish, you pull it out and you got one radish. Yeah, big deal. Well, if you let it go to seed, you get hundreds of pods off of just one plant. So you actually get more if you have a failure in your radishes. So turning those failures into successes is really simple. Just don't do anything, but make sure you keep them watered, okay? Radishes, whether they're young and they're forming bulbs or they're older, they definitely need a lot of water because their roots don't go that deep. So make sure you keep your radishes watered. Mulch them if you want, but don't worry about plucking them or keeping them standing up. They're going to fall all over the place. Make sure you don't grow them around things that require a lot of sun. Like I made a mistake. Well, I didn't make a mistake. I'm forming my own mistake. I make my own mistakes. I have my leeks growing right here. I have leeks over there. I have green onions, which are also known as spring onions, growing here, and they're right at harvest stage. Now, I've been clipping the radishes because they're sprawling everywhere. I've been clipping the radishes, eating the pods as fast as I can, and they just produce more. When you clip a radish, it grows more radish sprouts all over. They respond very well to being pruned, so clip off the tops if you want. They're going to come back. That's a harvest that you can count on in the hot season. And that's a perfect thing. And also, one thing that I haven't spoken about is right at your feet. Right here is what I want to talk about today because I'm growing something that I don't normally grow. And, the goats are playing. How cool is that? You haven't seen Bucky in a while. Maybe I should show you Bucky. Let me show you Bucky, and then I'll get to what I'm going to harvest. Okay, hold on just a second. Hey, Bucky. You're alive. People mention they don't see him that often. Well, he does come out, and he loves drinking out of this water bowl. And you may think, oh, that's cruel. He has to put his head through there to drink out of the water bowl. Well, actually, that water bowl isn't for him. It's for the wild birds. They have a huge, beautiful water bowl in their coop that's perfectly shaded. I change the water twice a day, and yeah, everybody loves you, Bucky. And but Bucky, he likes shoving his snout through there and drinking the birds' water. So I let him do what he wants to do. We have another visitor up here. Oh, well, he just took off. Never mind. But he's off and running. He doesn't stick around long. He takes long naps inside, and then he comes out, gets his drink of water, slams horns with a little fart head over here. And no, he's not that much of a bully. Lewis isn't a bully. He's just bigger and more playful. And then they both come out here. They butt heads. This is a ritual. And then they go out here into the jungle. Yes, the jungle. And they start foraging for grass and stuff. And I wanted to mention one last thing while I'm over here with you. Yeah, you can see all the weeds out there. But they love that. And, hello. That's a camera. Yeah. You're trying to get my microphone, you butthead. But out here, there are, the turkeys are out here. I haven't seen the turkeys in a while. And that means they're setting on eggs. Because I noticed I was getting about 9 eggs a day, maybe 9 to 10. And now I'm getting 2. And that doesn't mean that the chickens aren't laying. They're not molting or anything. What they're doing, they decided to lay out there because the rats were bothering them inside. So now, in those weeds, there must be about a half a dozen nests. Because I noticed some of my chickens aren't here, too. We haven't had any predators. I'm betting that there are at least, four, five, maybe six birds sitting on nests in those weeds. And those are thorns. Those are thistle. I'm not going out there. They're perfectly safe. So, cross your fingers, folks. I may have a surprise clutch or more than one clutch of little peeps coming in here any week now. So that's going to be kind of cool. Okay, let's get back to the garden. Thistle smell. Those thistle flowers are blowing in today, and so I can smell that. This farm experience is a 3D thing. It's the sights, the sounds, the smells, and the taste. The taste, yeah, definitely. This is definitely my breakfast. Now, by the way, one last thing on the radishes. If you let these pods age and you don't eat them all, just let them get big, they'll turn tan and dry. When they do that, pluck off the things, set them on a table, let them get bone dry, and then you can crack them open, and each one's going to have 3 to 4 to 5 seeds in it. Those are radish seeds, and you can plant those next year for your garden. So, if you have a failure, who cares? You'll at least have something to eat, and it's delicious. I think they're almost better than radishes themselves. And you get more of them, plus you get seeds for next year. Once you grow radishes, you really don't have to ever buy seeds for radishes again. It's a money saver, too. Now, right here, this conglomeration of stuff is on this side, this bed, this size, 2 by 10, something like that. I planted 4 Brussels sprouts plants, and I do like Brussels sprouts. Yeah, I love them. But I just never really had much of a luck growing them. And this year, I don't know if I'm having luck or not, because you won't know until you get the little tiny little cabbagette heads on the stem. And I noticed that something was eating the leaves. I think it might have been slugs. And if you ever have leaves, well, actually, come on over here, because I can tell you, but it's easier to show you, because a lot of people ask me about slugs and snails and stuff like that. Take a look at these leaves, and I'll show you what I'm talking about. See the holes? All kinds of holes in these leaves. Now, generally, there are a few different things that can cause this damage. Generally, holes in the center of your leaves are caused by slugs and snails. They love doing this kind of thing. In the middle of the night, they come out when it's moist, and we've had very, very humid days. So in the morning and in late in the evening, the dew comes out here, and it's a perfect setup for the slugs and snails. Now, like I said in last week's episode, water your garden in the morning and let it dry out for the evening, and you'll have less trouble. I'm not saying you'll have no trouble, but look at this. I have a few holes in the leaves, but I've been practicing that watering technique since I noticed the holes in the leaves. And the newer leaves, look, no holes. It's the older leaves before I changed my watering pattern. See? And let me go back over here to the same one. The ones that I was showing you, holes in the leaves, holes in the leaves. Look at the newer leaves in the center. Not a single hole. So this is a little advice, call it a tip if you want. It will help just a little bit. And if you see a few holes in your leaves, don't worry. It isn't going to hurt your plant. A few holes, not a big deal. So don't worry your mind about it. Now, if you see something like this, this is not slug or snail damage. This is caused by cabbage worms, and they will decimate your plants. They're little green worms or caterpillars. They're not fuzzy or anything, and they're very a beautiful shade of green. They only usually come out at night and early mornings. When the sun comes up, they hide. And where they do hide is generally right on the stem, lengthwise like this, or underneath. Now, the weird thing about it is, I know this is strange, I only have one leaf that got eaten like this, and I can't find the actual caterpillar. And the reason is, I have a ton of birds. And the birds come in here, the robins, the sparrows, all the other weird little birds, they come in and they just decimate all the insects in my garden. I'm lucky that way. And if I wouldn't have found this, that caterpillar, or the birds wouldn't have found it, that caterpillar could have just totally decimated this. Now, I'm going to swing over here to your right, bring the camera up. These are cauliflower. And cauliflower are delicious. I love cauliflower. I love broccoli. I just generally have not had a lot of luck with cauliflower and broccoli because they require, for me, they require a compost-rich soil, and they really drain the nutrients out of the soil. So with an established garden like I had up in Minnesota, it was possible. And I grew beautiful cauliflower, cabbages, and everything. But here, I haven't quite finished building up my soil. But I took a chance, just for the heck of it, and I threw in a bunch of compost to see if I could do it. Now, this is what a cauliflower plant looks like. Big, huge leaves. By the way, these leaves are very delicious. The younger leaves are better than the older leaves. You can chop these up and eat, turn them into smoothies, like kale smoothies. Use these leaves instead. They're just as good, highly nutritious. They're actually the most nutritious part of the plant, from what I understand, and they're very good for you. And they don't taste bad. Just don't eat the ribs, you know, the middle part of the leaves. They're not as good. And I've actually taken these leaves, steamed them, rolled them up with other vegetables and meat, and I made cabbage rolls. Yeah, I have a recipe somewhere. I have a video that I did that on. But let's get back to the cauliflower. Down inside, you're going to notice a white head if you're growing white cauliflower, and it starts out very small. This is called curd because it looks like curd. And what happens is it starts out a real teeny tiny yellow thing, a white thing, and it grows and it grows. And how big it's going to grow, that depends on the plant. But I wanted to show you this because once you notice the head starting to show gaps like this, you'll see a little bit of purple in there. And I don't know if this is showing the purple. Once it starts showing little gaps like that, your head is pretty much done. It isn't going to get much bigger. It's going to start spreading apart because these are individual flowers. Tons and tons of individual flowers. That's not just one flower. That's individual flowers. Hundreds of them. That means it's time to pick your cauliflower. Now, one way that you can slow the process down of it opening up, because it's a flower, once it sees the sun, it wants to form seeds. That's what they want to do. They're not here to feed you. They're here to produce seeds. We just happen to be here to eat them. Now, one trick that a lot of gardeners have used, and this is nothing new. I didn't invent this. This is just a practice that I use, okay? One way to slow the process. Now, here's one that I didn't cover up. And you can see it got really big. This is a nice size cauliflower. It's not a record size one, but you can see it's starting to turn a little purple here and open up. I'm picking these today. That's why I'm filming this today. Now, there was one that I did this to. I just took some string. You can take clips and clip these leaves together. As long as you shade the actual head of cauliflower, it slows the process down because it keeps it in shade. It's called blanching it. Now, I'm going to pop this off because I'm harvesting it today. And this is the oldest head, by the way. This one was the first one to form. And look, it's been here about maybe a week longer than the other ones. So it's at the same level, but it's been going here for quite a long time. And that's what you can do. You just bring the leaves together. Don't worry. And some people call it folding. When they're younger, you can fold them over and put something on top, and they'll grow that way. Or you can just bring them together and clip them. Hot weather is the enemy of coal crops. They don't like hot weather. They're easy to bolt when it comes to hot weather. They're cool weather crops. And that's why they grow really well. Like up in Alaska, they got the long days and the cool weather. You're growing cabbages and stuff in Alaska, you're set. They grow to record sizes up there. But they don't like hot weather. So I'm going to pick these because they're not going to do any better than they are now. This is as good as it gets for my cauliflower. I just wanted to show you these and tell you how I grow them. Not the definitive way. This is just my way of growing cauliflower. Now, when it does come time to pick cauliflower, there are many different ways to do it. The common way is to just push the leaves down, grab the head, and twist. That brings it up. Pull the leaves off. Easy peasy. Now, one thing I want to caution you about when it comes to cauliflower, this is out in nature. There are insects. There are things out in nature that you probably don't want to put in your mouth. And cauliflower, let me bring it up. Now, the underside of cauliflower shows the little hiding spaces where all kinds of insects can crawl in there and hide and surprise you when you least expect it, and you don't want that. When you pick your cauliflower, my advice to you, my best advice, is to pick it, get it in the house quickly, get a clean container, fill it full of cold water. You can throw a few ice cubes in there too to cool it down, because you want to cool the head down of cauliflower very, very fast. Otherwise, they don't stay as fresh as long. So cool it quickly. Soak it in water upside down. What this is going to do is cause the insects to crawl out of there and float out in the water, and it also cleans your cauliflower. Take it out, shake it off, shake out as much water as you can, put it in a Ziploc bag with air. Don't squeeze the air out. Leave the air in there. You can put it in your fridge and it'll store for quite some time and not get all slimy and nasty. Now when you're ready, just take it, pull off parts, dip it into some dip. I like buttermilk dressing or blue cheese dressing, and we just eat this as a snack. So I'm going to be picking all but one. Let me get over here. Little bird's getting bugs shoved down its throat. I got my cauliflower. It's a good day. By the way, one last thing is that you don't have to just eat these raw. There's a million different ways to cook these things. Casseroles, stir fries. My favorite way, my favorite way is to dip it and dip and just have it as a little snack. My second favorite way, actually tied for first, is just heat up some butter. Yeah, I know, I use butter because I like butter, okay? I'm not gonna use canola oil or anything like that. I like butter. Put some butter in a skillet, throw in a couple slivers of garlic, fresh garlic. Granulated garlic's okay if you don't have fresh garlic. Throw that in there, let the butter soak up the flavor until the garlic gets a little bit golden. You can smell it coming out. Throw in about a quarter cup of water, break up one of these heads into the florets is what they're called. Throw it in there, move it around a little bit, throw a lid on there and let it steam. What it's going to do is soften this up and then it soaks up the garlic butter flavor. And then you take those out, serve them as a side dish. Don't let them get soggy soft. Have a little bit of texture to it, al dente. And you are going to have an absolutely delicious side dish. And if you're me, it's probably a whole meal because I'll sit there and eat a whole head by myself. But anyway, that's my cauliflower and cold crop talk for today. If you have any questions or you just want to say hi, post in the comment section below. I have one more program to film and it's in the Voodoo Garden, and luckily it's in an air-conditioned house. But anyway, until next week, this is Ray on the Farm. Have a great day, everybody.